So, Blake and Jason, we meet again. It's been more than a year since season 17, and I bet you've forgotten all about me. Well, let me tell you something. I haven't forgotten how season 17 ended. I remember those things that you said about me, Box. And it's not just me, oh no. All of Great Britain was listening. We've been waiting, waiting and watching. We watched Neon Gnome. It wasn't very good. We watched She's With Me. We didn't like it. We watched Action Family. That one was pretty good. But I'm here to tell you, the Brits are back for another season. So, here's my question. Who's the daddy now, Blake and Jason? I'll tell you. I'm the daddy now.
She used to be an actress.
What's the pattern? Well, start again.
She used to be an actress.
She ever do anything I saw?
I think her biggest deal was she starred in a pilot.
What's a pilot?
Well, you know, the shows on TV.
Hey, I'm walking over here!
I don't watch TV.
Yeah, but you're aware there is an invention called a television, and on that invention, they show shows?
Yeah.
Well, the way they pick the shows on TV is they make one show, and that show's called a pilot. And they show that one show to people who pick the shows, and on the strength of that one show, they decide if they want to make more shows. Some get accepted and become TV programs. Some don't, become nothing. She started one of those ones that became nothing.
Oh, up until the end, you were killing it. At the end, last end, she just kind of gave up.
Nothing.
I was gonna say how good you did that.
I couldn't leave it there. Yeah.
Welcome to Couch Pilots. All of you are my friends. It's the show that dares to fly into the unknown territory of awful television. My name is Jason, and with me is my scene kid. It's Captain Philip Restisher.
Fuck the Lakers, right?
Oh, I suppose. It's going to be that sort of show.
Well, no, I just wanted to get that out right off the bat. I wanted to say it one time.
Why do you have to do it every time?
One time?
Every episode, it's three dog night with you. No, what?
Greatest fan ever.
They are pretty good.
Congratulations, guys, getting into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
Congratulations, Three Dog Night.
Sorry you can't have a concert and you're under COVID. You have to just do a live Zoom meeting. But hey, great job, guys. Thanks for having me. I appreciate it, Jason. I know that you did probably about watching the show, you probably did about an hour and 45 minutes worth of work.
A little bit more if you're talking about.
But okay, I'm going to add 15 minutes onto that because you fixed the Couch Pilots light-up sign.
Yeah, probably about a month ago, you were saying, hey, you need to do more for the show. And I was like,
yeah.
I carry the show like so much Atlas, right? What's that guy who's constantly pushing Sisyphus? He's constantly pushing that boulder up the hill, right?
That's me with this
program. And well, you just waltz down here in your underpants. Stained, I should say. Clean your underpants.
Well, hey, it's COVID. I just want to let you know that it looks great. It's very bright.
We have a sign that says Couch Pilots. It didn't work.
It says Couch Pilots Flight Night 69, because that's funny. A little joke. About a month ago, you just dropped all the letters off of it.
Yeah.
And so when you put it back on, you didn't line them up.
I didn't care to do it.
And then the frame is actually crooked, and I'm the one that has to look at it. You don't have to look at it.
You're facing it. It's behind me. It's giving me sort of an angelic glow behind my person. And I tell you what, I did it obscurely on purpose because today's pilot is very obscure and absurdist.
And so is our guest for this week.
About that. Let's go ahead.
Very obscure.
You introduce him.
Welcome to...
Ladies and gentlemen, this is one of my favorite guests. When I find that he's coming to my house, I get very, very giddy. I also have to try to get my shit together because I hold high regard to this gentleman. He has flown this plane. He has been on the show more than anyone else.
By fly this plane, you mean he's hosted an episode.
Yes, and he is a superstar.
Yeah.
Co-host. Welcome back to the show, the Lakers favorite fan, Mac.
We had it all right up to the last part. How's it going, everybody?
Kind of like when you do the intro. I'm telling you, you were killing it
that's
till
right.
the end.
Just nosedived at the end.
This guy's hair, and I mentioned it last week when he wasn't here, because I just knew it was going to be great. This guy's hair is in fuego, some would say.
Before we started the episode, there was a deep conversation about how you guys managed your hair.
How we groom.
It was delightful. Mm-hmm.
And I said, I shave it all off. And Matt's like, no.
You're not going to want to do that.
Not downstairs. Personal groom. We're talking about head hair.
Oh, okay. Because I was talking about like on my toes. Like I got a lot of hair on my toes.
Oh, see, I thought you were talking head hair too.
See, I thought you were
disregard everything I said.
I thought you were talking about.
You say head hair too?
I remember having a conversation about some kind of grooming before Matt got married. Do you remember that?
Oh, downstairs?
Yeah.
I don't remember it, but I have to assume that's what we're. Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, I didn't say it.
High and tight.
Anyway. It makes it look bigger.
His region looks like Kid and Play. It's a complete flat top.
Set your watch to it.
Matt, I was mentioning how nice your hair looks and how great it looks. And cheers. I was like, oh, you got post-COVID like a haircut. And you're like, no, I do it myself for a decade.
Yeah.
And I was like, self? Because that's how I refer to myself.
Self.
I was like... If this guy can do it, my wife can keep doing mine, and I won't have to spend $30 at a time.
Well, how about this? Those clippers that I probably paid $30 for them. They paid themselves off about a decade ago.
Thank you. It was if you look at his hair, you're like, and you find out that he's been doing it for a decade. You're like, that is a decade of decadence.
Yeah, I agree.
Well, let's be clear though. There's been a couple where
you've had to have it fixed a couple times. You've
either have it fixed or sometimes you have to hit reboot and
yeah, you got to
shave it all off.
Has it down three guard on top and a fade on the
three
sides,
dog night.
Yeah, three dog night on top.
Stop it with oh boy.
But
I went to a lunch the other day. Let me say this real quick.
There's you ate food. Wow.
And that's it. And that's the whole story. I had food and it was good.
Wow.
No, I went to a work lunch. These people I hadn't seen in like 4 or 5 months. I went and had a work lunch because one of these guys is moving to Memphis to work for Sam's Club. He's leaving Caterpillar to work for Sam's Club. Nice guy. There's only probably a handful of people I would have gone out to this lunch for, and I went for him. And he is he's a few years younger than me, but he's had the receding hairline for a long time. And he's always kept his hair very, very, very short.
How short was it?
Very. And he had mentioned, because we were all talking about haircuts, right? The conversation was COVID heavy, of course, because everyone hadn't seen each other.
Yep.
And this guy's like, I figure I've saved $4,000 cutting my hair. It's like, man, you had no hair to cut.
Right.
You guys are talking about doing haircuts at home with full, luscious, thick, beautiful heads of hair.
Okay, so...
That's a way different thing than just buzzing the whole thing off.
Right, so we have style to our hair.
Absolutely.
It's not just a buzz.
Hitler youth, some would say.
March 15th, April.
Matt doesn't May, like that at all.
June.
I'm processing it.
All right, so I'm saying I've had 4 months without having to pay for a haircut.
Yeah.
At let's say
you're doing like every 2 weeks because you're an insane person. Yeah, every 2 weeks.
All right, so $60 a month.
That's right.
That's $240.
Yeah.
I saved. Matt has been doing it for a decade of decadence.
A decade of desitin.
Give me that desitin.
Well, he's been a dad for a long time. 5 years. 4 years. 4 years?
Matt, where do you... how much money do you think you've saved? Have you ever done the math?
Mercy, no. And honestly, for a guy that's pretty hung up on numbers, I couldn't even begin.
He's a numbers guy.
I couldn't even begin.
$250,000?
Probably north of that, yeah. Probably north of that.
$300.
Oh, my goodness.
You bought... You basically... You
paid off my home.
Paid off your home.
Yeah.
We're trying to move some chords around. I was trying to be as eloquent as possible.
Oh, you were.
What I was going to say though is that this has been we're in the thick of the Tuckley 10.
Yeah.
Ooh, you betcha.
We're
in the thick of it.
We're you know what?
Knee deep.
Oh,
we're what?
God, go ahead. What do you got?
Pond deep.
We're the Loch Ness monster deep into the Tuckley 10.
If you must.
Oh. Now, that's of Scottish lore, is it not?
But that's part of the UK.
Musterons.
That's fair.
R-O-C-K in the UK. Of course, Chris Tuckley being a super fan of Couch Pilots all the way from England, giving us 10 links to 10 separate failed pilots, giving him his very own season of Couch Pilots, aptly known as the Tuckley 10-2, as an episode, or a season 17, we had done 10 other episodes strictly from the UK.
He's a gift.
He is
a gift. His writing is a gift as well.
Oh, he truly is.
Mercy.
He's a poet, and you know what?
I hope he knows it.
I think he knows
it. Well, what I was going to say, though, is to tie it back to the... To our grooming and our own haircutting.
Let's talk about our grooming.
You want to talk some more about
your kid and play nuts? Well,
is that I had not invested in a long, long time. I basically just used very rudimentary tools to cut my hair. And then COVID.
A chisel.
Rock, paper, scissors.
Sure, yeah.
Fire.
Fire, good. No fire, bad. It's like a haircut. Yeah. Fire.
My 23andMe profile came back, and I was more I was more Neanderthal than like
you were man.
70
than you were Homo erectus.
Than like 70% of the population that's done it. So I felt kind of
that could account for your for your second extra vertebrae.
Yeah, I have 26. Where most of us have 24, but
He has two extra vertebrae.
I've got four, so
I would. You know what? If it meant I could run Iron Man like it was nothing, I'm not trying to diminish the amount of work you put into it at all. But I would gladly have two extra vertebrae.
Yeah,
that's the unknown. That's you just nailed it. The
unknown posse.
Well, the untold truth of Iron Man is that most of us are more Neanderthal than the rest of the
population. There's a lot of bloody knuckle trails just dragging upon the ground.
But no, I finally invested in some. I was telling Jay before, thinning shears. And regular like nice scissors.
They are expensive, right?
Oh, you bet. But I found a decent deal from across the pond, and the gentleman who shipped them to me, Chris, I had no idea you were in the business, but those thinning shears are magic.
Hey, there's two things that Chris Tuckley knows about.
One,
Vikings.
Two,
haircut
thinning shears.
He makes one of a pair of thinning shears.
He doesn't just sell them. He makes them.
Yeah.
Holy crow.
Think about it.
Yeah.
If all you know is Vikings, you can only talk about that for so much time.
Pardon the pun, but you got to cut out the middle man. Make them yourself and sell them directly to the populace.
That's pretty good.
Not too bad. So what did we say we were going to talk about? Damn dirty haircuts. My squirrels.
Yeah, your squirrel nut zippers, which you saw in concert, didn't know.
No, I know you said I brought it up seven times before we started, but I only brought it up once that I saw the squirrel nut zippers.
No, you've brought it up like four or five times.
No, I never have.
Roy Garcia, check that.
Actually, I'll say this. I've never brought them up, but I will say.
What are you, Donald Trump?
I have a squirrel fascination right now. And I have an update in the lore of the squirrels. Do you know about this?
I've seen it. Well, you've shown me a picture.
Okay.
You built a temple.
Well, yeah. To kind of build on a previous episode of Couch Pilots, I'm working at a home. I'm in my kitchen sitting at the counter. I face out a window all day. I would see...
Why don't you just turn around?
Because then there would be no counter there.
Oh.
So I'm looking out the window and I see God's creatures running about. I see squirrels. I see chipmunks.
Deers.
Right? I see deer. I see an antelope. What else do I see?
Huh?
What else do I see?
A larmer?
I see a larmer. That's right. Beautiful, thick-coated larmers.
Dolphins.
Mm-hmm. Man in a dolphin suit.
No, he wasn't in a dolphin suit.
The world was full of water. But I see these squirrels, and so I build a ladder up to the ledge of my window that I'm looking at, and these squirrels...
You need attention so much.
Kevin Costner.
I don't need attention as much as I need to be entertained. They're not paying attention to me.
You don't think they're not looking in there and going, hey.
They can't see it. No, it's like a reflection.
Look at him being an LPA.
I'm not an LPA.
You're not? What's your title?
None of your goddamn business.
No, what is your title? You're an LPA.
No, I'm not an LPA.
What are you?
It's none of your business what I am.
Fuck you.
Anyway, I said, you know what? I just cut down this huge part
what
of the tree.
What are you? What's your
I'm not going to tell you. I'm not going to tell you now. I don't like the way you're talking to me. I don't like the way you're looking at me. I don't even really like the t-shirt you're wearing right now. I'm not going to tell you. I do like the t-shirt. But I built this squirrel house, and I put it on this tree, and that's where the trouble began.
Oh, trouble.
Shoot.
Starts with T, it rhymes with P, and that stands for pool.
Pool?
That's a Music Man reference. So I put this on the tree, on this big stump. It's about 5.5 feet up in the air.
I would have made it a little bit different. I would have done some other things, but it really looked pretty good for what you do.
I appreciate that. And honestly, it was, I don't know, were you laughing at that? For what you do? What does that mean? Is that a slight?
No, I'm just saying, to me, you kind of like just threw it together. I mean, you could have stained it. You could have used a router.
Well, maybe if I come up with a cheesy name for all the shit that I make and get a stepson, maybe I could make some stuff that's up to your quality of woodworking.
I feel like we're heading down the remediation path again. Or
step aside. Cut his mic.
I mean, can you admit that, like, you didn't need to use L brackets? I was kind
of
like...
First of all, L brackets isn't a real thing.
No, what do you mean it's not a real thing? You used L brackets. You didn't need to. You could have glued it and then Brad nailed it, and so you wouldn't have to see those. But
look, if you want to nail Brad in your own also, time, that's your business.
The other part of it was you had on your plywood. You could see the end of it was where it was spray painted.
So what?
I mean, they're squirrels, for God's sake.
I've not had one squirrel come up to me and say, "Could you have done something different with the paint?" You know what? Forget the story.
I want to hear the story.
I don't want to drag this out 25 minutes like your sideways drunken bachelor party story. No. Okay. They recommend the squirrel houses be 10 to 30 feet up in the air. Sure. Mine's about 5.5, so it's not a good height. I found an iPhone the other day on the road.
You put it in the squirrel
house. I put it in the squirrel house. I thought, this is kind of like a big screen television.
Find my phone.
But no, I found it on the street. And so like I kind of got paranoid. Cause no, it was weird because I found this iPhone while I was on my walk. I go for like 70-minute walks almost every day. And I find this phone on the ground, and I'm waiting for someone to call it so I can say, "I have your phone. Meet me at the Taco John's. Buy me a refried burrito, and you can have your phone back."
Right.
No one called. No one texted. That was a very weird thing about a phone. Yeah. No calls. No, it's very bizarre. So I get paranoid at night because I see a strange car driving up and down my street. So I look out the window. Instead of another car, I see a whole gang of raccoons walk by.
Their phone.
I thought I was going to say a car squirrel.
Well, even when I was leaving your place that night, and there was a car with at least four people in it.
It was that night, absolutely.
Creeping up and down the street.
So I kind of got freaked after that. And then I look out my window and I see a bunch of raccoons, all right? The next day, the squirrel house is kind of, it's tilted 90 degrees on top of that stump. I was like, "Oh, that's not good."
Well, it's because you put it on with like a Velcro strap.
No, I didn't. I screwed in something else. I think it was between that and raccoons messing with it.
Okay.
I fix it up. A few days later, I come back and I see, I spent the night at my girlfriend's house. I pull up to my house in the morning and the whole house is on the ground. And there was a body in my neighbor's yard.
What?
No, shut your mouth. You're lying.
A raccoon body.
Oh.
It was an adolescent raccoon. It was a good size.
Who cares about those?
It got real.
Raccoon lives don't matter.
So I was like, "Oh my God." And then I got some disturbance in my garage, and I have all my mouse traps go off, but no mouse in them, so I get bigger traps. And today I go in there, and I find a chipmunk has been killed in my garage. And I feel like, although I'm trying to feed these local wildlife and entertain myself by having them come up just inches from my face while I'm working, it's delightful. I feel like I'm bringing death upon the neighborhood. I feel terrible because that raccoon, it was very bizarre. I got home and I see the raccoon on the ground. I was like, there should be no raccoons here. And I go see it and it's breathing.
Oh, boy. Oh, that sucks.
Yeah, that's a tough one.
And it breathes all day. And at the end of the night, it goes into the literal death throes where it's kind of moving around and then it does finally die.
Do you think that maybe like you should have at some point from the time you got home to the evening, you probably should have done something to like
kill it,
help it, get to a higher place? No.
I was debating that. Yes. I was debating whether or not I should kill it and how I would do it. Like, honestly, I had you ever hear of blue tongue disease? It's not something you got in college.
No, it's like a deer. It's a, yeah.
It is.
It was like blue tick disease, but blue tongue maybe is the.
Okay, that's right. It afflicted deers in our area a few years ago and really thinned out the deer population a lot. It gives the deer a fever and the want to go near water. So you'd find deer carcasses near creeks.
Yep.
Okay.
We had one out on our property that died like that.
Yes. Yep. That's exactly. And I had one in my neighborhood that died in my neighbor's, or it was real sick and it was in my neighbor's yard. And the police came by
and
shot it with a 9mm, and then a Caterpillar tractor came down the street, picked it up, took it away.
Yeah.
So I'm thinking, man, if I had a Foyd card and a gun,
if you owned a 9,
I could shoot this thing.
Would you do it sideways? Or would you do it like
sideways bram, bram, every time? Bram, bram, every time. Bram. I'm a gangster for life.
Oh, for sure.
So I wait until it dies, and then I take it up the hill and toss it. But I feel like my fascination and want to help the squirrel and chipmunk population has turned into me bringing death.
It sounds like Darwinism is like there's some I don't know. Someone's fighting for territory.
Somebody wants
here.
That iPhone. Yeah. Somebody wants
the iPhone's gone. I turned it in. That's
turned
something
into
else.
What?
That's something else.
Turned
to
into
happen.
What?
Do you want to hear this? Listen to this. So I look at the iPhone and it says Sprint at the top. So that's the carrier, right? So I go down to the Sprint store the next day after you're over, Matt, because I got paranoid about people like tracking it and coming to my house.
Well, I texted you that morning and I think you said, "Yeah, I'm going to drop this off," but
and I did.
It's the last I heard. Yeah.
So I go down to the Sprint store, which like it's 2003 in there, and I get out of my car and I start walking across the parking lot.
And there was a dead raccoon.
There was a dead raccoon still breathing, not dead at all. Two employees of the Sprint store come out of the store and approach me, and they say, "Excuse me, do you have a mask in your car or at home?" And I said, "No, I have one in my pocket."
You didn't say pocket.
And he said, "Well, could you please put it on?" And I was like, "I'm 15 fucking feet from the door. I was going to put one on." Like, without you asking me,
right?
I put it on in every, no matter what store I go into, I just put one on automatically without people asking me.
Yeah, that's bizarre.
Well, they wanted you to put it on your face.
No,
though.
I tell you what they are. They're a couple of assholes who want to get out their goddamn phones and fucking film me so they can put it on Reddit and make fun of me. Asshole. So I go in there and I was like, "You guys don't even give me a chance to put my mask on." And he's like, "Oh, it's just procedure." I was like, "Whatever." He's like, "What brings you into the store?" I was like, "I found this phone. I'm not doing business with this piece of shit Sprint." I'm sorry if you guys have Sprint. And I said, I found this phone. I just want to return it." And he takes it and he walks away and he starts to press it on his computer. I was like, "Are we good?" He's like, "Yeah." And then I leave. Like, what kind of fucking service is that? You have Sprint? Yeah,
I do. And
fuck
I,
them.
That, is that the store down there on the riverfront?
Yes, it is.
It's pretty rough.
Fuck them.
Yeah.
Are you a Sprint?
No.
Good. Anyway, that really pissed me off. That's it. You guys are caught up with my life. I'm sorry to talk so much.
Okay, so I wanted to talk about one thing here real quick.
I feel bad.
I was warned about this. I don't know what this is, though.
Well,
this is the thing?
There's a lot
is
of
this a thing?
There is a lot of stuff I want to talk about. But I have a complaint about Instagram. Okay?
The something related to the show that you never use?
No, I use it every day, but not for our show.
Okay. Go ahead. Let's talk about it.
All right. So I follow a couple of Instagram accounts. Okay? _ crossdresser, lover, you know, stuff like that.
Are you hearing this?
Just random stuff.
This is exactly what I thought he was going to reveal to us. Please go.
I don't.
He's gay. He's going to release.
No, I'm not gay.
No. You didn't hear that.
No. I'm not...
What do you got, Matt?
No. I have no ground. Like, I'm literally... I have no idea. No context.
He's following cross-dressers on Instagram.
Okay.
I you obviously haven't listened to the show, but
don't care that you're gay.
No, Molly's,
I'm not gay.
We don't
I'm
care.
Not gay.
We love you.
I'm saying that
Molly's talked about the only thing I'm thinking of for context is that Molly's talked about that like RuPaul's drag show or something like that. Yeah. Doesn't she watch that? No?
That's
lightweight shit for this guy.
Okay. That's all I got. Yeah.
We don't care. We love you. It doesn't matter what
we
goes in
you,
where.
It goes in the same spots.
Go ahead.
Anyway, so on Instagram, I follow a couple accounts that have to do with transvestites and cross-dressers.
Doesn't matter why. Go ahead.
Right. I'm starting to wonder. I'm sorry, Matt.
I just have no idea what's going on right now.
Sorry. So anyway, I'm kind of getting frustrated. I'm thinking about contacting these hosts of the
Smart.
Instagram
account. You should definitely do that.
Because
I have no idea why.
I'm going to tell you why. Because I don't think that when they're posting all these girls on here that they're actually transvestites or crossdressers. I think they're just like
you think they're
smoking hot chicks. And they're like, you know, hashtag... _ crossdresser.
So you're mad that the smoking hot actual women on there.
He thinks it's counterfeit.
Yeah, exactly.
He thinks it's
exactly.
You're not there for that.
No, I just think that if I'm gonna follow you on Instagram,
be real.
Be real.
You want authenticity.
Yeah, yeah.
Matt, you ever know a transgender person?
I don't think so.
No?
No. Right. Like, do you mean like within my circle or inner circle, like somebody what,
just the big old
know
circle
of them.
Just the big just old like circle.
Big old circle.
Someone you've met.
You ever talked to one?
Nobody comes to mind.
I've known a couple.
Have you?
And
have you worked with someone or have you?
No. Should I tell this story about? I think I told you before.
I don't think so. I would have known about this one.
Okay, so a few years ago, I mean, like probably 3-4 years ago, I was out with this lady, and we meet her friends at a bar, and one of her friends is like a lady who says, "I'm not a lady at all. I'm a fella." All right. So I don't know. She
just brought that up like randomly.
No, she looks like.
How do you lead into that?
No. This is. I surmise this. And actually, the lady I was with told me to. But she looks like. Like a shorter, very short-haired, you know, kind of a...
Butch.
A butch-looking...
Okay.
So we're all sitting at a table, and I say... we're talking about something, and that person chimes in. Is like, she agrees with me. And everyone else at the table immediately says, she, like almost in unison. And I was like, oh, okay, I'm sorry. No problem.
You said he?
I thought you must have said he.
Yeah, because you said
sorry.
She.
I'm sorry, I said she. They said he.
They okay. said he.
I'm
okay.
sorry. You're right. So, and everyone was cool about it.
Yep.
Everyone was fine. And I was like, oh, okay, no problem. He, that's cool. And then later, the lady that I was with was like, hey, this person, this transgender person, kind of thought you were cute.
Nice.
And so I'm thinking,
Wrong way, but like, nice.
No, not wrong way at all.
No, definitely wrong way.
Well,
in my opinion.
For you.
So they were a she as a he. Oh, I see. Okay.
So I'm thinking, like, would it be weird if I, like, pursued this person that physically and anatomically is a she, but said I'm a he. And nothing ever happened. I haven't seen that person since, but it was an interesting thing that came up in my head.
Sure.
And so then I dated some other girl later who's like a step sister became a fella or something too. But other than that, I don't have a ton of experience with that.
But the closest, oh, I'm sorry, go
no,
ahead.
No,
the closest I get is something.
I was at this bar. No.
Blake doesn't count.
A basketball court circa 2003 in Savoy, Illinois. Believe it or not.
He went out. This other person bet him a pair of jeans.
Oh, yeah. that's a good story. That's how I got my first pair of ladies' jeans.
That was in Raceway.
That was
Savoy, home of Triptych Brewing.
There you go. No, we were going to play some. Pickup ball, some folks we did not know. They showed up to the courts.
Poor choice of words. Pickup ball. Go ahead.
And how do you,
if I remember
if you
right,
don't know them, how did you set it up?
We just all ended up on the basketball court at the same time.
Oh, so you made it sound like you had it, like you both.
It's a pretty
common both teams were supposed to meet at a certain time.
Oh, no. This is one of those rare instances where I think it was like in an apartment complex too, if I remember this right. Anyway, so all I did was kept calling, how'd this work? I kept calling a he, a she, no, a she, a he. Mm. I thought it was a her, and they kept going him.
Yeah.
And it didn't click for me. I was very dense, but all I was thinking about was the game, and I kept using the wrong pronoun, and they were polite about it. No one, like, punched my lights out, but right. It was, I kept saying.
You never know how people are going to react, but I think as long as you're positive and genuine sure. about your response.
No.
People are very receptive.
I felt
to,
about, I know they can't see me over past the mic here, but yeah, I felt about this big when I did it.
And you are already short. Like, you're definitely a point guard. You are not playing power forward.
He's of average height.
You are not playing power forward.
Matt is average height.
And when I say power forward.
You've ever said for me, Jay. Yeah.
What'd you say?
This is the nicest thing you've ever said to me. I kid. He's said some very kind things to me.
We're all of average height in here.
I'm above average height.
You're not above average in anything, if you ask me.
talent. Anyway, he looked at the soundboard and chose not to push a button on that one. No, it's too late. Fuck it.
It's not even plugged in.
Oh, because I have something going on here.
Okay, yeah. Go ahead and get to your thing.
So I'm just saying, if you are going to have a Instagram account where young ladies who are transgender submit their photos, don't post ones if you don't know for sure. I feel cheated.
Are these so? When you say she, is that are they he? Are they he's who are she's or she's who are he's?
They are he's.
C's with D's.
They're C's with D's.
Chicks with dicks.
Okay,
but that's
okay.
That's rude. So that's rude to say, by the way.
But can't some of the chicks remove the dicks though?
Huh?
Can't some of the chicks remove the dicks?
Yeah, but on some of these, you're like, oh, I don't, you know.
That's the whole conceit, though.
So anatomically, they are he's, but they are
chromosome-wise.
But they identify as she's.
That's why I followed the account.
Blake followed because there are C's that currently have the D's.
But a lot of times they look like C's with no D's.
Right, right. Because they did a good Tuckley job.
Oh, gosh. I'm sorry, Chris.
No. There's doing a good Tuckley job, and there's no Tuckley there.
Mm-hmm.
I shouldn't have brought it up. First of all, I should have brought it up because Matt's here.
I feel like I gave you the cords to your phone. What do you have on your phone?
I have a voicemail, baby.
No way. Oh, my God.
Here we go.
Hello, this is Ted Bundy calling for a Blake Clinton. I see you are just thinking about starting a podcast about famous serial killers. I would like to be part of your podcast. Just don't tell my wife, Peggy, or my children, Bud and Kelly. Otherwise, I'll have to go back to my job as a bald, fat professional wrestler. So once again, this is Ted Kennedy, prolific murderer and sometimes author. You can contact me anytime, day or night. Thanks. Bye.
Gotta admit,
I was on.
Hello, this.
It's the same one over again. Don't get excited.
That had some layers to it.
That had a lot of layers, and I was very impressed by the. I was very impressed by all the. What do you call them?
Well, he there's Al Bundy reference in there. There's
Al and Peggy Bundy.
There's Ted Bundy.
Kennedy.
There's Ted Kennedy, and there was also King Kong Bundy referenced in there as
right.
well.
Right, and that to me,
that's good.
Pretty good.
Covered a lot of ground in 90 seconds. Yeah.
But
pretty good voicemail. That was Lucas, was it?
Yeah, I was on a podcast with
Lucas. No, that was actually Ted Bundy, by the way.
Oh.
Yeah, you said it at the beginning.
I thought it was Al Bundy, yeah.
It was Ted.
I thought it was King Kong Bundy.
Kong Bundy.
It was Ted Kennedy. But I am thinking about doing a serial killer podcast.
Are any of those guys still with us?
King Kong Bundy's not.
Ed O'Neill.
Al Bundy's dead.
He's alive.
Ed O'Neill, who played Al Bundy, is still alive.
He's dead.
He's dead. No, well, I thought Matt says he's dead.
He's dead to me.
King Kong Bundy, dead.
Jeez.
Ted Bundy, dead.
I never thought that would have come out of your mouth.
I couldn't resist.
Besides Kobe Bryant, I thought that would never come out of your
mouth.
Call
him Cody?
No, Kobe. You know.
Show some respect.
I don't think we've had Matt on since Kobe Bryant died.
We shouldn't go. I'd rather stay on Al Bundy.
Well, let me ask you real quick.
Because he's not dead yet. I'm not dead yet.
He's a Lakers fan. So
all right, is he really?
Well,
fuck that guy.
I have nothing negative to say about Kobe Bryant.
Thank you very much.
About the deceased.
That reminds me of that.
Is that
tragedy.
Bad karma? It's bad karma, right?
That'll sit on your house for
talking about Kobe Bryant reminds me of that tragedy.
Kobe Bryant wouldn't sit on your house. He'd fly a helicopter into it.
Hold on a second.
You gotta have something for that.
Is that it?
New low. Yeah, new low.
I'm gonna feel real bad.
Ooh, I like this song.
Come on, let's go.
Can you bring us back from that one, Jay? Is there anything you can do?
No, there's nothing I can do.
Now he's not looking at me. when you're podcasting with Matt and he's not looking at you,
I'm coming back around.
It's awkward. it's like, oh God, I made him mad.
Derek,
he's very good at bouncing back and forth, but for a long period of time, if he's not looking at you, you're like, oh fuck.
I was coming back.
How do I get him back?
We love you, Blake.
Go NBA.
Derek wanted me to call
him. Go the NBA.
I'm not going to call him. Adam Z asked if we're still recording. I think he's going to call us.
Well, just call him.
No, I'm not going to call him.
All right.
Today we discuss the pilot episode of Clubzarathustra from the year of our Lord, 1996. Not to tell you, for real, for me, great year. 1996.
It's a great year.
It was a good year for the Roses. I was getting on the regs by then. I was knee deep. I think 96 was probably...
That's prime time for Poon for you.
That was probably the girl who I had sex with, and she bought me clothes. Remember that?
That's your gene story, right?
Yeah.
Ours is a lot different. For sure.
Mine was more enjoyable than yours.
We all have a denim story.
Sorry.
She would buy stuff from...
They were stonewashed.
Was it Bergner's, right?
Yeah, Bergner's. Yeah, for
steel
sure.
Trap.
Yeah.
You know what? I would like to see what she looks like now.
I don't care.
No, I do. I think there's about five or six young ladies. Well, they were young at the time. Well, not that young.
really happy with yourself. Anything, right?
How do you segue off that, Jay? You're a pro.
There were a few ladies of age when I was young.
Ooh, mercy.
That I would like to know what they look like now. I know Angie Vecchio looks horrible.
Do you Google your exes? Do you ever look them up online to try to find them?
I don't remember the last names.
Yeah. Some of them you may have never known their last names.
Maybe they're using an alias of some kind.
She had such big boobs.
All right, very good. Anyway, Matt, when you think of 1996, does something come to your mind?
The Lakers.
That's freshman year. That's Fulton Junior High School. You mentioned Speedway, Indiana. Yes. That's, I don't know, kind of coming of age, 14 years old.
Shoot. Absolutely.
Yeah, yeah. 14, 15, absolutely. Somewhere in there. Yeah.
So you were balling, right?
I was beating the pants off of
really
neighborhood, cross neighborhood. Remember, because he brings it back over.
So, like, I think before the summer's over, mm-hmm. We should do a YouTube video mm-hmm. of me and you playing one on one.
Do you play?
Oh,
one on one what?
Basketball.
We're gonna compare our Instagram accounts.
I was gonna say Matt's not on Instagram, but you beat me to it.
No, I will.
All right.
You just wait.
Matt.
I'll show you an Instagram.
Matt, me and you. But you know what? I think to end the Tuckley 10, the final episode of the Tuckley 10.
You and me playing cricket.
Me and you should have a game of b-ball, one-on-one to five.
Okay.
You want to do that?
Yeah, let's do it.
Bring the recorder there. And we'll
Yeah, we'll videotape it, me and you.
Hold on a second.
Say 5, 11. How about 11?
Hold on a second.
Sometimes I start off cold.
Okay, we'll play to 11.
Hello?
Hey, Jason, it's Adam.
Hey, Adam Z.
The podcast formerly known as Low Blow.
I have you in my phone. Like, you put first name, last name, and then you can also put company in. And in company, I have Low Blow Podcast. So it comes up as Adam Z, Low Blow Podcast.
Nice. How are you guys recording still?
No.
Blake says no.
You're not recording?
No.
Okay, hi, Blake.
Hey, buddy.
Matt's here. Going? Matt's here, too.
Hey,
oh, hi, Matt.
Hey, man. Adam Z.
Adam, just so you know, that last episode that we recorded, I defended you in your ear.
My ear?
Derek yell at you in your ear at the bachelor party?
Oh, God. He screamed so loud, it rang for like 45 minutes.
I did not know about that at all until Blake brought it up in his 25-minute story.
I totally forgot about that. Yeah, he did. I'm like, this is uncomfortable. My ear has COVID.
What did you say? You texted me before you called. You said, I just saw the greatest robbery of this or any generation. Is that right?
Well, not greatest, but dumbest. Dumbest, if you guys have a minute.
You saw it in person?
Yeah, I witnessed it. I did not get video of it because, you know, reasons.
All right. Make it quick. I would love to hear it.
All right, so I walked into the Walgreens. I wanted to get some Skinny Pop because I'm on a diet. And then I hear the cashiers yelling at a man, a gentleman, in a face mask, so he was, you know, corona proper, screaming, hey, stop that. You can't do that. We're going to call the cops. And then there's this gentleman in the blue shirt, and he had two boxes of diapers. Now, I understand times are tough. Stealing diapers is not a funny thing. However, one of these boxes of diapers had a security device attached to the shelf, right? So instead of putting that box of diapers down and stealing the other four next to him, he steals the entire shelf and starts running through the store with the shelf dragging behind him. He gets to the front door, and the shelf is too wide to get through the door.
You saw this?
It literally happened 5 minutes ago.
Is this by your house? Or,
yeah, this is a block from my apartment.
I've been to his apartment. It's pretty nice.
Thanks. So as he's trying to get through the door, the shelf gets stuck and like is hovering in midair as he's holding onto these boxes of diapers. He's just like trying to get through, and they're like, "Just put them down, man. You can have the one you have in your hand. Just go." So finally, he like wiggles the shelf out and proceeds to run down the block with the diapers and the shelf still attached.
What?
Why are you talking to us right now? Shouldn't you be giving like an eyewitness account to the police?
Or the dog? Or Chicago. They're not going to be here for like 2 hours.
Or the dog police?
No. Ooh, dog police. They're more attentive.
McGruff, the crime dog?
So are you going to call the Portland Police Department and see what you can do?
Did you say Portman?
Portland.
The Portman?
No, Portland.
Portland? No.
Hold on a second.
It seems like it'd be out of their jurisdiction, but I mean.
They don't have a police force.
I think a lot of times you just make stuff up that I say.
Where do you think he is? Where do you think Blake or Adam Z is?
Portland, Oregon.
Where's Blake? I know where Blake is. Adam Z is in Portland, Oregon right now.
Okay. I just want to make sure. That's right.
That's where I'm at.
He's at the fish market.
Cost of living's ridiculous there.
Fish market.
I can't call the feds.
Well, I wouldn't call them. I'd call McGruff the crime dog.
Yeah, that's right.
You get a better chance of something happening.
Take a bite. He, you know, Adam Z, McGruff only wore a trench coat.
Yeah.
He was completely nude under there.
Like him and Dick Tracy.
Yeah, did you ever wonder, like, that was weird? Like, he's the crime dog, but everybody can see his red rocket? Like, I was not comfortable with that.
That was a medical condition he had.
Yeah, that was a medical condition.
It's called syphilis.
Okay. So Gruff was just a lady dog then?
He had penile rosacea.
Okay.
Cool. Goodbye, Adam.
Anyway, I wanted to share that with you guys because I'm retired from podcasting, so I don't have one, and I know you guys are always.
You're not retired. You're just too lazy to do one.
I don't have a co-host.
Will you? Never mind. I'm not gonna say anything.
You should get. You should. You and Chrissy should do one together.
She won't. She won't. You know she won't. I love her, but she won't.
I don't know she won't. I met her once for like 15 minutes. I don't know her like that.
Yeah, she won't podcast.
Okay, I believe you.
Yeah, she'll karaoke, but she won't podcast.
Well, but you won't, and Dave's done.
It's the same thing. Karaoke and podcasting is exactly the same thing.
You explain it to her when we're down there August 1st.
Or you just give us her phone number right now and we call her.
No, she's still working. We're not doing that.
Oh, where does she work?
She works from home. She's in marketing.
What's the address?
Not happening.
Blake, look up work from home Chrissy Chicago on Google. We'll find the number. Okay, Adam, thank you so much.
I love you guys.
I love you too.
You.
Goodbye.
See you, man.
Bye.
Bye.
Maybe now we can get back to a real podcast on like Low Blows. Jeez. That was a. But that there's two parts of that story. Part of me in that story is like, damn, this guy is so desperate for diapers for his kid.
It is kind of a sobering thought, though, isn't it? Like,
right. But then I'm like, here's a stupid guy who has a kid, and he's too dumb to steal diapers correctly. So it's a catch-22.
Like, shelters will give out that kind of thing, right?
Well, like, but if he would just get on his iPhone and Google that shelters, because he has an iPhone. He probably has an iPhone 11 XL.
That's a nice phone.
It's
just saying, nice phone.
But he probably has that phone in his pocket. Mm. He could take the time to try to find that out.
You get cloth diapers, take it out back, hose it down, flow through the wash.
There's options.
Yeah, there's options. Yeah. You don't have to steal. But
that's what I'm saying. It's a little bit of both. You're like, oh, this.
I thought he was going down the path of like he just witnessed like a holdup of some kind, like at the counter. When he started talking about the counter, I'm thinking, oh, shoot.
Well, there was a holdup of poop.
Oh. Can't do it.
Yeah, high five.
Call it. Oh, don't see let me that? Join. That's
no one's stopping you from making that noise with your mouth. This?
No, because
I asked him not to.
Great editing.
Matt goes, love you, but don't do this.
1996. Don't do that. Let's go back there in our minds. And to do so, we'll talk about things that happened not only in the United States history, but in UK history.
Yes, yes, yes.
August of 1996. And we do this so we can properly get in the mind frame of the pilot we're watching today so we can judge it, digest it, and regurgitate something accurate.
In our minds.
Okay, that's fine. You know what? I love your enthusiasm. August 14th, unemployment has fallen to 2,126,200, its lowest level since the summer of 1991.
And we're saying that's for the UK or that's for the States?
That's for the UK.
That seems like a big number.
It does seem like, okay.
It's like a massive number.
How many people live in the United States,
340 million, something like that.
That's I think that's pretty damn close. Yeah. I would say 330 something, but yeah. I think your market.
Yeah, it's close.
UK? I would say a fraction of that.
It's like they're 20, basically that. No, like there's the size of Michigan. I think it's for
the, really? Yeah. Mm-hmm. The size, I mean,
well, the
land mass.
Land mass, yes. Yeah. I don't
know. So, like 20,000.
Oh, the Europe is very compact.
Yes.
How many people do you really think is in the UK? Gosh. Like 20 million?
I was going to go. 50 million? Believe it or not, I was going to go less than 20. But are you saying the UK? Are you saying England? Or are you saying like the British Isle? Like,
I don't know. Whatever. Hey, you know what? Who gives a shit?
20,000 people. Sorry, Chris. Just go with that.
20,000 people. Smaller than Peoria, Illinois.
Gosh, the I entire, wouldn't guess that.
Including London. Well, the entire residence.
They should probably update their census. I don't if you know how that works.
If you count the sheep, it's probably like 47,000.
Oh, that's true. Yeah. And their census, too.
Huh?
August 17th, on the first day of the English League season, David Beckham scores a spectacular goal from inside his own half as Manchester United beats Wimbledon 3-0 at Selhurst Park.
You want to talk about a guy whose hair is on point?
I do want to. Yeah.
David Beckham.
Bend it like Beckham, right? Come on. Isn't it?
Well, I guess, but...
Yeah, no, that's bend him like Beckham is a thing.
Right, but it's like an Indian girl.
I think the phrase is bend them.
No.
Bend them like a Beckham.
Isn't he married to Sporty Spice?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey. Victoria?
Secret.
She's on your Instagram?
No.
And I don't know if you guys know this, but Victoria Beckham, huge dick.
Really?
Yeah, and you can see it on Blake's Instagram.
Hold on. Victoria Beckham.
Oh, he's really interested for some reason. Now, Blake, you're not a soccer guy.
No, I've watched the other day I watched I worked the Moose and there's no sports on obviously and I watched on the TV we had like 4 hours of frisbee football and that reminded me a lot of soccer. It takes forever, nothing happens, and there's a lot of people on the field.
Matt, I agree. It's a lot of
does,
nothing.
Does Chris Tuckley like soccer?
It's the biggest sport in the world. I'm sure they does by far. Yeah,
yeah, it's far and away the biggest sport. Matt. I've known you since like a junior year of high school.
Yeah.
I've always known you to be a very fit and athletic guy, but I don't know you to play organized sports within school. Were you ever a soccer guy?
Yeah, absolutely.
And so how many years?
All of my organized sports happened before I got to East Peoria.
And how many years of soccer did you play?
Oh, gosh.
Seven.
Yeah, yeah. Seven, yeah. 8 years, probably somewhere in there.
And how does Blake know that and I don't?
Well, I mean,
I think he threw a dart there, but no, yeah, that was probably.
We hang out a lot.
You guys hang out a lot?
Yeah.
On Instagram.
You guys are part of the same forums?
Well, we have a podcast.
Hold on a second.
Me and Matt have a podcast.
This is all coming very fast.
Well, I don't know why this hasn't come up before. What, you have a podcast together?
Yeah.
What's it about? What? Where can I
about see? His Instagram account?
It's called. Nope.
C's with D's?
I'm not doing it because I like Matt too much. I have respect for him.
Not sure how.
And
that
that's all
in?
The show is about.
As much as him trying to respect you.
No.
Makes for great radio.
Here's what happens is I push play and I start talking and then I look at Matt and I go, oh, fuck it.
Well, there's something else I can't say.
Well, what do you want to talk
the
about?
The show's almost pure silence now.
You. Next week's episode, we talk about hummingbirds.
Mm-hmm. Wow!
And then I get really, And then I get in trouble.
Local wildlife. Yeah.
Oh boy! August 28th, the Prince and Princess of Wales complete their divorce proceedings after 15 years of marriage. Their separation was first announced nearly 4 years ago. The former Princess of Wales loses her title of Royal Highness and assumes the title
Royal Hiney.
No, that's a great guess. Educated and intelligent guess.
Hold on. Princess of Dykes.
Boy.
Slightly less educated guess. Assumes the title Diana, Princess of Wales.
Oh, it's Princess Diana? Oh, no. Shit. I feel bad.
P. Di.
Rest in peace.
R.I.P. P. Di.
P. Di.
So she would... When did she die? 90?
Like 97.
Yeah. So... there's a Peoria tie in all of this. When she's in the accident, it's
was it an accident though, Matt?
Okay, well, it's said that while she was in the operating room, a very well known local cardiothoracic surgeon, Dr. Geis, if you know that name, here locally in Peoria.
Is he like a St. Francis guy?
So he's donated a lot of property. I'm sure he's worked at both hospitals, but I don't know who his contract was
with. Dr. Geis.
Dr. Geis.
G-I-E-S-S?
Mm-hmm. And so he, yes. And he had an understudy, Dr. Fortuna, but he's now left and he's in Arizona. But anyway, Dr. Geis was here for ages, and it said that he received a call that night from the surgeons that had Princess Di on
and
the table.
And he was here, but they were consulting with him.
That's right. And they were consulting with Dr. Geis.
I had no idea. That's the first I've ever heard of that.
Yep. And Dr. Fortuna at the time would have been his probably understudy.
His
Dr.
ward. Geis or,
protege.
And, but Dr. Fortuna is not out in Arizona. Anyway, yeah.
Wow.
There's a little.
Wow.
Did you know?
Great job.
Well, cheers. With that information about the consulting Dr. Geis, that puts me squarely back in 1996. How old were you then? I think we already said that. We don't need to say it again. Matt, why did we choose to watch Club Zarathustra?
This guy's going to get it.
I got it.
Hold on. I'll play some music.
Give me the...
this is special.
The 8-bit one.
Matt, this is special.
You got it?
This one's special. No, this is special.
Hold on. He's got it. There's four reasons.
Four?
You got it.
There's only one episode.
Whether it aired or not is...
Whether they're irrelevant.
Thank you.
Had to be free. Come on, we're not going to pay for this.
Right.
And it had to be available online. And this fourth one.
No, I'm not sure. You know what it is. What is this season?
A Tuckley 10.
Yeah!
Oh,
got
yeah!
Baby!
He Tuckley'd it like it was nobody's
business. That was for you, Chris.
You know what? To be ironic.
I'm a big Chris fan.
The problem that I came up with earlier that I was talking about earlier.
Yeah.
It's because they're not Tuckley'ing it right.
Mm-hmm. Hold on a second.
Is this...
Come on, Chris. That was good.
You can find the entire episode of Club Zarathustra by subscribing to Couch Pilots on SoundCloud, Spotify. Actually, not SoundCloud at all. Or Apple Podcasts, or your favorite podcast app of choice, minus SoundCloud. And then simply click on one of our classically blue links in our show notes. Or go to YouTube, Matt.
You'll know what to do, Tube.
Is it me or are these episodes getting really long?
It's like the...
We're only 15.
The Hoover Hangover.
That's good. I like that a lot.
And we're only about,
it works on so many levels.
We're only about 30 minutes in.
Is that all? It feels.
It's been like an hour.
It feels longer.
It's been like an hour.
It's been an hour.
Summary of the pilot. Pilot for the fringe comedy cabaret act and troupe known as Club Zarathustra. Blake, grade it.
I'm going to give it a B minus.
Okay. I'm never in the room for anything higher than a C. I feel like you guys let me grade it once, and I was ashamed to even try.
So are you too ashamed to try right now, or do you want to give a stab?
Oh, I would never do. No, the last time was a massive failure.
We will we'll move past that then, and we'll move directly into interesting facts.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm proud to announce the Tuckley 10 Interesting Facts segment. Please, don't take someone else's experience. By hearing these facts, Jason has spent a lot of time smoking fags and on the internet trying to find facts about this show that you may not know. Jason,
you don't know what hard times are, Daddy.
Hail the Queen and proceed.
All right, interesting facts.
Hail the Queen and proceed.
Boy,
I agree.
There's a lot packed into that. Right
hail there. The Queen and proceed.
I think he's broke.
I'm asking you to.
I'm trying to.
Say, I hail the proceed.
I hail the proceedment.
Don't touch the royal thighs.
I won't touch the royal thigh.
Ooh, I love this.
Club Zarathustra. It's spelled C-L-U-U-B. And it looks like you think it's
club.
A club.
Bouncing Clube. In the club, so come give me a hug. I'm into having a sex sign and making love.
So come give me a hug.
Birthday.
Birthday. It's pronounced Club, though. They keep saying Club.
That's what I was going to say, but Club has got to have it like K-L-U-U-B.
Do you remember the Crystal Club?
I had the Club once. The doctor gave me some cream for it.
The high school.
And you're going to want to high-five that shit.
Crystal Club. Yeah.
Do you remember? We did an episode as a British show called The Crystal Club. And I tell you what, that was a zero in all accounts.
What is a club? I mean, what are we talking?
Well, it was spelled C-U-B-E, but with this show, it's pronounced Club.
Mm.
The Crystal Cube.
Fair enough.
As it were. It was awful.
Yeah.
Club Zarathustra was a, and if I'm saying it wrong, I apologize. It was a fringe comedy cabaret act and troupe active between 1994 and 1997, developed by Simon Munnery and Roger Mann as a Dadaist comedy club night act at the Market Town. At the Market Tavern. Club Zarathustra was a fringe. That's the same thing I just read. They spurned traditional stand-up comedy in favor of the surreal and absurd. Their credo was, we aim to fascinate, not entertain. Fact.
It is what it is.
It began as a comedy club in Islington, London, twice went to the Edinburgh Festival Fringe, and was eventually given a Channel 4 television pilot filmed at Ealing Studios on a vast stage that was never broadcast and cost £120,000.
Mercy.
Which is about $13?
It's about $355 million American dollars.
No, it's not.
The currency is,
I'm bad with currency.
The dollar to pound pair has really...
If I had to guess, I would say $150,000.
Yeah, that's probably close.
There's two
currently, yeah.
There's two things I don't know about.
One.
Time zones.
B.
And currency.
Yeah. Amen to that. Throughout the show, we get testimonials of the subworms, opinions from people who have been saved by Club Zarathustra. The audience are actual worms and presumably remain unsaved, shot on cheap, degraded videotape to great effect. The pilot script features cameos from all of the cast members in these roles, but most were cut from the final edit.
Ooh, I didn't know
Fact.
That.
Fact.
Well, it only ended up being 20 minutes before it was all said and done.
And from what this fact says, I believe there were only two testimonials.
Yeah.
But there were
the girl and the guy. Yeah.
But there's a handful of people that were part of this group, and those are the only two that were actually included.
Well, it's funny you mentioned the audience, because all it is all I remember is it was like a quick smash cut to one lady, maybe in a sea of red, and it was maybe her replicated throughout the rest.
Yes, it looked like almost like an Asian lady, didn't it?
Maybe, I don't know. It happened fast. That's pretty
funny. No. It wasn't because it was funny.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, speaking of which...
He's on another level, Jay.
Another thing that I'm into right now is if you go to YouTube and you
know what to...
Yeah. You know what to do, too? I'm going to tell you what to do, too. Is if you,
tell me what to do, too.
If you type in Asian female drummers...
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty awesome. It's
pretty is cool. This on your...
Is this put this on Instagram. This sounds more like an Instagram thing.
No, it's YouTube.
Yeah, maybe
it's YouTube.
Hold that for our podcast.
Yeah,
save that for our
my bad.
And I do have to apologize. Just so we can properly promote it, what is the name of your podcast?
Club Zarathustra.
With the pilot in the can, everyone seemed to assume that a series would definitely follow. Channel 4 commissioned 6 scripts and plans were afoot to film the actual series during a run at the Edinburgh Festival, which would presumably have glossed over all the worries of the pilot fact.
Fact.
It is also the subject of a 2002 book called You Are Nothing, a history book written and researched by Robert Worringham and published in 2012 by Go Faster Stripe. It is suggested in the book that Club Zarathustra was the progenitor of much British comedy from the 1990s to present day.
Hmm.
So they're saying not necessarily the pilot in particular, but just that cabaret act, that live show of this group influenced so much of comedy in Britain today.
It didn't strike me as a series of any kind. It struck me as, I don't know.
Just a special?
Like a standing special. Yeah.
Like a Netflix special.
Hmm.
Kind of like a Netflix special?
Yeah. What Netflix is like, what, 04 when they start their thing?
Probably the mailing of
the mailings. Yeah.
Finally, Stuart Lee later joined and helped in the vision and organization of the club. Other members were Johnny Vegas, Julian Barat, Lori Luxenberg, Richard Thomas, Richard Herring, Jason Freeman, Sally Phillips, and Kevin Eldon. It directly led to the television series Attention Scum and the production of Jerry Springer the Opera. Interesting facts over. This is an Asian drummer. Can you play that for a little bit, YP?
Yeah.
She's wailing on it, sure.
Hold on a minute. This is... So, Matt, I know...
Describe what you're seeing.
Well, hold on. I'm going to skip to... I didn't pick the right one. Oh, no. So, basically, this is... upcoming female drummers in the world.
How did you stumble on this?
Matt, I can't tell you that. But so basically, what I've found is there's a lot of Asian women. There's a lot of Asian women that
in Peoria.
No. There's a lot of Asian women that are drumming, like mm-hmm. they're drummers. And what they do is they have a tendency to wear like very scandalous outfits.
Okay.
So here, I'll make it big so you can see.
Scandalous. Like, looks like she just got like a.
So she's got her. She's got
like a tube top on or something.
A very small top, and then she's got a garter belt on.
Oh, okay, I see it now. Yeah. Yep, yep.
So, and she is a very good drummer. Her name is A/.
She's doing some Welcome to the Jungle.
Y-E-O-N. And there's another one called Juna, J-U-N-N-A.
Okay.
And to be honest with you, they're really good. But this, you gotta watch this one.
Okay. She's going to town.
But they're really talented, and I think what has happened is they have there's a couple of them that have found a market of like, hey, if I don't wear a lot of clothes mm-hmm. and I can kill it on the fucking drums,
yep. folks are going to tune in.
And I have a YouTube video.
That's what I was going to say. Is, like, is this channel? On Twitch? Is this on YouTube?
YouTube. Yeah. So, yeah. So definitely check out A/YEON. She's very Sabatrue. She did Sabatrue.
Sabatrue.
By Metallica. Eye of the Tiger, but also the Juna, J-U-N-N-A. Check her out on YouTube because like she's the most animated. Mm. Like,
well, she was getting into it there.
Oh, yep. Let me give you a couple seconds. Oh, God damn it. You know what I hate is when people send me money for stuff I need to build. I don't want money until I've built it.
For sure. Yeah, the pressure
mostly gets when it's like amped. It's like $100. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
So, but hold on a second.
What is happening here?
We're watching Asian girls.
Are we?
Yeah, they're drumming.
I don't feel like anything's happening.
It's pretty cool.
Buffering.
Yeah. Well, we can come back to that after we attack some Twitter responses. Sing Twitter responses to this beat.
Twitter responses. Twitter responses. Jason probably got some Twitter responses.
That's not going into the microphone at all. People can't hear it properly.
No, I was just showing you.
We're doing a show.
We got this.
What's a show?
There are no Twitter responses, okay? No one from Club Zarathustra, whatever, is contacting us. So,
24 years old now.
While Blake runs away to the bathroom where I previously was, he's got a surprise waiting for him in there, I tell you what. we're going to break down the pilot episode. How would you say this is? You saw it. They said the name of the program. Am I saying it correctly? How would you
it's
say
probably
it?
How I'd go. I'm tempted to say Klub, but that's
what I've been saying, right? Yeah. Klub?
Oh, I thought we had reverted back to Club.
No, no. Klub what?
Zarathustra?
That's what I've been saying. Yeah, I think that's it. Let's put 10 minutes on the clock. And Matt, you and I can start talking about this anyway. Go, yeah. Please start us off.
So it starts off in a, I'll call it a World War II, like a French World War II steam room where a gentleman's downstairs just hammering away on
something. Black and white.
Yeah, yeah. And a guy walks down the stairs and I don't know, they have some kind of exchange. And then it cuts to this, I think it cuts to the theater where there's this like Harry Potter / Mike Myers love child on stage.
There is like an intro in between there. And I will say that if I was a better host of this show, then I would have downloaded some sort of app that would translate what the French were saying into what
I heard. I caught we. I don't know. That's
and that means yes?
Yeah. There you go.
But there is like a color, and there's an announcement made, and there's people marching. It basically says, "Attention, scum!
Yes, you
are nothing." It's basically like an alert system or warning system, just saying, "Hey, this thing is beginning. You are nothing."
And there's even like soldiers' footsteps, or maybe that's just people marching. Marching, something like that.
And there's when they're showing stuff on the screen, it's like typed up like on an old typewriter, like just like slits of paper.
Yeah.
So on stage, you got a man in a robe. And you say he looks like Mike Myers as Austin Powers, is that right?
No, it's a Harry Potter Mike Myers love child.
I said he also looked like a young
Mike Lillian. Myers is Canadian, though. Harry Potter is very much a British-ish or a UK.
Canada is basically where
it's British
the
Columbia.
United States, mm-hmm. France, and the UK have come together.
Sure. That's what's.
I said he looked like
French-Canadian.
Like a young Willy Wonka?
Maybe. I kid you not. I wrote down something about Willy Wonka.
So this person who's the host of this thing is standing on a stage. He's addressing the camera and an audience like last week's the Craig Ferguson show, kind of. But in this way, he's speaking in a very weird version of the English language, and someone's translating for him. That's a very short part of it. And then he puts on a large hat, and he looks like the Mad Hatter now.
Sure.
And he's definitely in front of some sort of audience, and he's talking about different sayings. And one of his favorite sayings is, "Get out of my way." And he also says, "Brevity is the soul of wit. Wake, thus I win." I don't understand some of these things that they're doing.
And it's going very fast. Like
There's a certain pace to it, for sure.
For sure.
Another saying is something about a punch in the gut is worth something. Or there's a lot of different sayings that he's just kind of belting out.
He was talking about the Holy Land, and it was Holland.
It seems very like, this man is in charge. Uh-huh. He's delivering a message to a group of people, and there's almost sort of like a monarchy kind of thing.
Dictatorship.
There's that piece of it. I think there was almost like this weird religious overtone to it, like
a cult. A lot of the things I looked up kept mentioning the word cult.
A personality.
If you think of like the Sermon on the Mount, there's these segments that go, "It is often said, but ... and that's what he's doing up there. He's going, "It's often said," and then.
That's from the Bible. It's often said. They say
it's something along that line.
And it's probably these people are like kind of, again, Dadaist, absurd comedy people. There's probably no, it's not a coincidence that they're using this type of language.
I would say.
The actual passage, it's often said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, but I tell you. And that's kind of what I thought like he was doing up there. Is there's just like this court jester, like you mentioned. There's this whole mess of culture that's all hitting stage at
and
one
that person
time.
Like you said, a jester or a messenger comes and he says something from Holland or Holy Land, and he says, "Oh no, you said Holland,
right?
The weed is legal in Holland," which is where Amsterdam is, where it is obviously legal. And then there's like fake clips of a large audience, like you had referenced earlier, Matt, clapping. And they're all wearing dunce hats at one point.
Right. I'll have to see it again, but I think it's the same. I see at least the gal in the front row. I thought it was almost her the entire way through the back.
I think you're right.
Yeah.
And then he says, "Birmingham, Siamese cat, King of Siam. None of these things have anything in common." And then he connects them with like a wire and a drawing. It's all absurd. Everything you're seeing is absurd.
Yeah. It's pure absurdity.
And then we go, he does this. There's a bit with the a heavy metal opera, and it's a lady comes on this humongous metal opera outfit.
Yeah, it has some like Rocky Horror picture show to it.
She's probably 12, 15 foot tall.
And she has very like Madonna pointy breasts.
Yeah, it's...
And then he makes a breast joke, which...
He whacks her on the boobs a few times.
How can you not do that?
Well, she sings a song for Europe, and then the lyrics scroll below, and he says, "Yeah, why do you love men breasts? Because you get two of them, there's good value there." And that's why men love breasts.
It's like a Costco commercial.
Have they done one of the smash cuts yet to like the folks that were touting how they've been saved by the Zarathustra? Have they done one of those yet?
That first one with the lady had already happened, I think.
Oh, did it really? Okay.
And I didn't understand it. The first one was something about her haircut I didn't understand.
She said, I was bald, but now I can see." Again, "I was blind, but now I can see." "I was bald, but now I can see."
It's not a coincidence.
No.
These people are doing this on purpose. There's a lot of pre-recorded bits. Again, kind of like the Craig Ferguson show.
Sure.
You'd have this man touting this nonsense as a possible cult leader, I think is what he's doing.
Yeah.
And then interstitialed with these pre-recorded bits, one of the first ones of which is two men on kind of the top of the hill meeting, and they're by themselves, and one's like, I have a tall hat, and the other one like presses a button or does something, and his hat grows.
When he's right. The main character too, or he's the gentleman on stage, yes. Right? Yeah, yes. He keeps defending the honor of his hat.
Right, and this will happen 3 or 4 times during the episode, right, where they have these pre-recorded bits about how...
These two men meeting with their hats.
And their hats.
Yeah. And the next bit is back on the stage, and it says that we have three wise monkeys. Hear no evil, see no evil.
And sports monkey.
And sports monkey, play no volleyball.
Yeah, play no volleyball.
Which is ridiculous, but kind of funny.
Yeah.
The host of the thing, goes to play volleyball with his monkey, and instantly, during the game, the volleyball deflates, and the ape becomes very sad.
Sure. And then they have a pen versus sword. He yes. talks about, and then versus tank. At the end of it, his comments were like, they say the pen is mightier than the sword. Mm-hmm. And he's like, no, it's not. This is why. And then at the end of it, he's like, oh, well, the tank is more, you know, powerful than anything.
I noticed this earlier, but this is the first time I noticed that it's like mimicking what he's doing. The host is standing there kind of talking on the stage, but behind him is a very large circle with his face in it, and I thought it was a still of his face, and it may have been at the beginning, but...
I didn't catch that.
As it went on further, it seemed that it was like a live shot of him.
Right.
Like, so it's a massive face of himself behind him doing
very
this.
Cult-esque, yeah.
And the next bit was the Shakespearean of the Year, and a guy was telling a poem, and it was called Confusion.
Is this where he says, my name's Paul and I'm a pud?
Did he say pud?
I thought he did.
It was the one with the last part of it was like a still of like a little cup of tea and like a jelly glazed donut. And just yeah. And it stayed on it for a long time, which was
naturally. It was very absurd poem about like moss and spinach and some lady's dead
a girl.
Daughter.
And then he wipes his knuckle mm-hmm. off on a wall. Yeah, no, I loved it.
I
can't believe I revealed that. Sorry. Oh.
Another testimonial, and this is both legs equal. So he's basically saying, when I first joined this cult, my legs were uneven, but now they've grown to match each other. And this is very much like a cult with members. Mm-hmm. Don't you agree?
This is the David Koresh stuff.
The feel, definitely for sure.
Branch Davidians for sure.
And then he starts doing a bit where he has a pair of women's knickers,
kind of a fear of undergarments, right?
Which
doesn't he end up with one on his head somehow?
Yeah,
the knickers are on his head, and
nipple compartments is what he called.
He shows the bra, and he has his picture on the inside of the bras.
Yep.
And it says, is his face, and he says, thus I win. Yeah. I'm not sure what he means when he says
he's playing
that.
By his own rules, for
because
sure.
Because every bit at the end of it basically shows him that he's in power, right? Like, and it, like yeah. Or makes a reference to his power.
And then he says,
power comes from his hat.
All men are women, and I only speak to women who are supermodels, and I only speak to them for a few seconds. It's very odd and like overtly pretentious.
Sure.
Then you have another segment where this the pre-recorded thing where the two men are on the hill again. The host bows to the other man, and he's wearing a cannon hat, and the cannon hat destroys part of the other hat, which is looks like a castle.
Yeah, for sure.
Very odd.
I liked it. Then we go back to the industrial with a French guy, and he's just pounding on a piece of metal.
I don't know what to make of these bits.
There's steam in the back.
It's the industrial revolution.
I thought it was kind of World War II-esque, but yeah.
One and the same, perhaps.
Yeah.
About the same
overlap
time.
There, sure.
Hey, Coke is it.
It is Coke.
Yeah. And I find a little tidbit for you. On my YouTube endeavors, I saw this gentleman that starred in this on a different show or a different bit. And that was one of the bits he did with the screen behind him. It was Coke Is It.
It was separate from this, or it was a clip of this?
It was separate of this.
Really?
And, yeah.
So you recycled that bit into something else?
Yeah. Actually, there's like 3 or 4 things that I saw that they recycled.
Interesting. Now, the host is now in the woods, and he approaches a fella he calls the Fool, and the Fool tells a riddle, and he keeps teleporting. I didn't understand the
it's
riddle.
Like a court jester is what I
yeah.
think
yeah,
it is.
I think yeah. he called him the Fool, but you're right. It'd yeah, be like yeah. a jester.
I put riddle troll.
Yeah.
And the riddle didn't make any sense because the three things he said, and the guy's like, I don't know. And then he said the answer, and it didn't coincide with that.
I didn't get it at all. And then there is a, he's talking about an unstoppable force and an immovable object. And it's an experiment where he punches his own face and he says, nothing happens. Do you want to see sparks? Is that what you want?
Oh, and that was.
And then the stage erupts.
And they spent about $12,000 on these pyrotechnics. Like,
that was the majority of their
third of the budget.
Yeah. And then there is a platform that comes up, and I thought it was going to be Tommy Lee from Motley Crue.
I was hoping. Oh, my God. I was hoping.
And it was a guy sitting at a in a lounge chair of leather descent, and he had one of those big globes like that you would, like old-time globes, and he starts reading this or telling the story, and it didn't make any sense to me.
So back, what would this have been?
1974.
October 74.
You're on the court. You're on the court.
Beating the pants off. Playing to 11.
With James Worthy.
Yeah.
He had his glasses on.
Chris Tuckley and I have had an exchange, I think it was on Twitter.
Did you guys fight?
About C.S. Lewis, who's So he's an author from the UK. He's no longer with us.
R.I.P.
R.I.P. But I went to a night with C.S. Lewis, which is now a gentleman who plays the part of C.S. Lewis, sits there in his study, and talks about his life. This very much felt like that, just for a moment. Like he goes up on a platform.
And do you think maybe it was kind of like a spoof on that, maybe?
Oh, I don't know. I don't know if C.S. Lewis
probably not that well. Specifically.
Sure,
because that was a man who was... Yeah, right there?
Yeah.
But it was that setting, for sure.
Okay.
Yeah. I remember when you went to that. That was really cool.
It was like the Playboy guy. What was his name?
Hugh Hefner?
Yeah, in his, like, lounge...
His leisure suit.
It was like leisure suit Larry, and you had to go from room to room and try to have sex with people on a computer game.
You know what? That's almost exactly what it was like. But instead, that man comes up, and he's saying, I don't tolerate birds in my house because I'm allergic... I have some folks coming over, including my family, and then, of course, Terrence Trent D'Arby. Do you remember Terrence Trent D'Arby?
I didn't get this.
Do you remember the song?
You're saying there's he makes a reference to this guy?
He says his name.
I didn't catch it.
Do you know that song?
No.
When they hit the chorus, you guys might know it.
Are you gonna have to give credit in the show notes to this?
Probably. Absolutely not. Well, no. I will get an email from YouTube saying.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I just ignore him. No.
This is late '80s.
Yeah, that's why I didn't know anything about it. Because I was cool by then.
Yeah.
Hey, you say potato, I say cool.
Monkey see, monkey do.
Monkey see, monkey do.
All right.
That went too long with
all
with
right.
No, with no hook.
It. I couldn't find the hook. You're right. I'm sorry.
And so that ends with
him going back into the stage.
Terrence Denton D'Arby.
Thank you.
And they go back to another hat bit, and the guy's like, I have the tallest hat. And the guy's like, yep, you do. And then because they're facing forward, and then he turns. And he's got these big pillars, like, you know.
Coming from the front straight out, and from the back straight back.
And he said it's all about the width.
He turns and he knocks over the guy. The guy's hat.
And he knocks his hat off, yeah.
Yeah. So
knock the hat off. Knock the hat off.
And then back on the stage, there's a different guy up here now, and he's all in black. And he's talking to someone off stage about, like, a hat being what's most important for a person. And the guy's like, well, I don't have a hat. And then it goes to black, and it says, insert more money.
Well, if you listen to the credits starting to roll, these two people start talking about, and they had another hat bit, but they didn't have enough money for it.
It seems like a very meta bit where they're talking about, we ran out of budget to do what we wanted to do for this show.
For the ending, yeah.
It reminded me a lot of... what's the name of that Mike Mitchell TV show? What's Happening with Mike Mitchell or something? Or what's going on with Mike Mitchell?
Or Fat Fucker Mike Mitchell.
Or Big Fat Fuck Doughboy Mike Mitchell.
Speaking of that, I don't mean to cut you off. I apologize. Well, you did.
Okay.
But on last week's episode recording.
Of Doughboys?
Yeah, they talk about Doughboys Double. Mm-hmm. And they start, Mike Mitchell brings up doing pilot doing shows about pilots, TV shows.
Well, he can eat it because we're way ahead of him.
He can eat his own dick if he could ever get near it.
Well, the Mike Mitchell pilot, basically at the end, he's almost like begging FX to pick up his show.
Right. Yeah.
And that's what I feel like this is. This is a very kind of meta moment where they're saying, hey, you know, we if you gave us more money, we could do a better program. I don't know, I'm sure it was on purpose. Sure. You know,
there's something to it.
And so the cast is talking over, and then you think that's the end because you're seeing the credits, but you're getting a third and final black and white factory thing, yep. Industrial age, World War II, whatever you want to call it. And then the fella that keep coming down the stairs and talking to the guy working is apparently shot or something.
But you don't see who shoots him?
You don't see that. And then the guy who's doing the work goes over and checks out his body, and apparently the fella has a tail. And then that's it.
I turned it off before that. Sorry, guys. I didn't know.
That's always your MO, is as soon as you see one word of credit,
he's gone.
Like, you could hit pause and be like, oh, there's 3 minutes left. No, I watched. But you just say, fuck it.
I watched Chris Ferguson dance for like 30 Craig. Seconds. Oh.
The end. Good Lord.
We did it.
I guess.
Matt, it's not over yet.
We did it.
Don't get excited. It's not over yet.
The shows are getting too long. All right. Often we say, you know, where would this go if it survived? What would we do to improve it? Why didn't this show work? In this case, and sometimes I do, I have a little bit of an answer or an insight why the show didn't work. And it is noted that several of the people involved in the program cite the transition from cabaret night to TV production itself as being problematic and near impossible. Simon Munnery, I believe that is one of the guys who created the program, felt that the performers were too removed from the audience to make the pilot a success, while Cassidy, another member of Club Zarathustra, in Robert Warham's excellent book on the Club, You Are Nothing, cites the decision to make it so big a production, it took away some of the magic that made Club Zarathustra a success in the first place. So maybe saying giving a big live audience or having a national audience takes away from the intimate feel of doing it in a tiny club.
That makes sense.
And kind of the spirit and the feeling that is evoked from having such a small audience.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I would agree with that. I also think that it's absurd, which is great. It's witty in a nerdy way.
Yep.
I think that it's creative, but I don't think you can give that to the masses. You can't give that to a regular national audience, and enough people will get it.
It's so niche. It feels niche.
Absolutely
so niche.
It feels niche to me.
And it's exactly the word I was thinking. And I know it's a word that you love. It's such a niche thing.
Niche. Yeah.
That
it's a niche.
Yeah. It's
even
it's
for
such
like a UK, because that's what I'm asking myself. Is like, what is a UK audience looking for?
Absolutely fabulous
porn. People smoking cigarettes.
Yeah.
Murders of their queens.
Well, what would you? Okay, so you have this cabaret act that's popular in a certain circle. What would you do to improve this to maybe make it more accessible to the UK audience?
I'm not saying this to be inappropriate, but don't you want some girls in this? Don't you want some?
You
raciness?
Got like a 15-foot girl in a giant tin man.
I know
she was one of the members.
Do
of
you
the want club?
To show some skin? Like you know?
Oh,
what I mean?
You're talking about making it sexier.
Yes.
Okay.
For a broad audience on quote unquote UK national television or whatever, BBC, don't you want to add a little
Okay, maybe so. I don't know.
It seemed like a lot of testosterone, like a nerdy testosterone for me.
It was very few people involved.
It was very Monty
Python. It was a very limited cast.
It was very Monty Python-ish, don't you think?
That fits.
Thank you, Matt.
I don't think you can exist in the UK past like 1975 and not be influenced.
I don't think
by
Mr. Bean Monty is. Python. I don't think Mr. Bean is Monty Python at all.
You don't think so? Okay.
No, I don't.
I think he's pretty absurd, but okay.
Mm.
Okay.
Well, he's absurd, but to me, Mr. Bean is like.
And we kind of talked about Mr. Bean a couple weeks ago with Rowan Atkinson. What was the name of that show that we did?
Canned Laughter.
Thank you.
And I think that, like, to me, like Mr. Bean is like Steve Martin stand-up without as many words.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
I can't see that. Yeah.
So, but I don't think Monty Python is either one of those. But I this was very mighty, 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 mighty,
hate thongs.
Mighty Mighty Boss Tones.
Never knocked on wood.
Yeah. Have you ever?
I know someone who has.
Yeah.
I'm sure it isn't good. Matt, if this were to survive, if the UK is very odd about this shit. They call seasons series.
Like nine episodes.
And every series has about like six episodes. Yeah. And every TV show that goes the distance is like around for like 12 episodes
total. It's going the distance.
Where would you...
It's going for
speed. If it survived, where would you see this going? Would it be more of the same?
I would want to see... Okay, so I would probably want to see, especially since this is supposed to be some kind of faux stage performance, like take me backstage. Let me see some of the, I don't know, inner workings of all of this madness.
So you have all this pomp and circumstance on the stage, but you want to see maybe some of the actual vulnerable sides of the performers.
Of the performers and as they're transitioning and maybe some, I don't know. But that's kind of where we are now. It's like we want to see how things get...
Everything is very meta.
Everything's
how the
very
sausage gets made.
Back. Like, sure. You want to see the cameraman laughing or
how
something.
How the fudge
like.
Is packed. Right? Nothing funny about that?
How they tuck the dick.
I'm not sure that fits in at
I'm
all.
I'm sorry. I said it wrong. How to tuckle the dick.
Thank you. Thanks for cleaning that up.
I've lost my train of thought.
I apologize.
But going backstage.
Sure. Show me how it all works, because if there is all of this madness and it's all just we're just seeing the surface level, the byproduct of all that
madness. Madness is a very good word here. Yeah, I think there is a lot of madness happening here.
It's very Alice in Wonderland in a lot of ways. There's a big rabbit hole that they're charging down.
Speaking of C.S. Lewis, huh? Mm-hmm. Well, his buddy was Lewis Carroll, wasn't it? Oh, it was Tolkien.
Tolkien.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I keep mixing those up because Carroll was.
Alice in Wonderland.
Yeah. She used to pull her ear at the end of the show.
Who?
Carol.
Lewis Carroll Burnett. Is that who you're talking about? Hi, Grandma.
Ladies and gentlemen,
I thought it was good.
Is that who it was? Was she saying hi to her mom or her grandma?
Mom.
Okay. You know Carol Burnett, right?
Carol
Burnett?
Went to high school with her.
You went. Hold on a second.
We used to be on the same pickup team.
This is
she can dunk like a motherfucker.
This is an interesting pilot in the effects that it seemed to be a widely influential comedy troupe in the 90s for the UK.
But it didn't go anywhere.
Obviously that, but like there's not a lot of information about it. It's not an IMDb. That was odd to me. Mm-hmm. These people who have gone on to different levels of success and it not being anywhere in IMDb, even though it obviously exists, there's nothing in Rotten Tomatoes. There's nothing in IMDb. There are some reviews, and I'll read from those here real quick. Critic reviews, Mark from Random Rambling Thoughts and Fiction says, the series was not to be. Indeed, the pilot was not even broadcast. Such as Club Zarathustra as a televisual experience remains a tantalizing missed opportunity. It's true that something is altered when you take the inherent ramshackle live experience to the screen and the essential joke that originated in such shambolic incubator surrounding the scumbaiting league and his loyal brainwashed followers does seem a little lost when portrayed with a big budget. But Club Zarathustra remains startlingly good and radically different from example of TV comedy. SOTCAA, or Some of the Corpses Are Amusing, says, Channel 4 had the option to turn Club Z into one of its best-remembered comedy shows of the 90s. The never-transmitted Avalon TV pilot of the fabled stage show proves this. The pilot show looks magnificent, transforming the humble pub stage show into a genuinely original and absorbing bit of telly. Its faults are simply the faults in any pilot. A few vaguely stilted graphics and odd awkward pause. Munnery, in contrast to his quick-fire, ultra-confident air these days, looks somewhat stilted and nervous in his main role, but this adds more than a little to the always evident but never actually stated vulnerability of the character. With a couple of eclectic camera shots to raise it above the traditional look of your average live comedy on TV show and tighter performances or editing, the show would be there. The set, as designed by Harry Banks, is fantastic, overbearing, and forbidding. The pre-film sequences are also well executed, including a sequence for Paul Hamilton, who takes his bland verse to locations worthy of their imagery. Every heavy-handed bit of cliched poetic symbolism now only reserved for schools and colleges shows, is parodied here. So there you go. Club Zarathustra could have been huge, thwarted by artless TV execs. What more can we say? I don't know. I think we could say something, right?
We'll find a way.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to FCF Airport. Local time is 11:11, and the temperature is 69 degrees. For your safety and comfort, please remain seated with your seatbelt fastened.
A voice of an angel.
And you get to go to bed with it every night.
Every night.
Lucky duck.
And there's a 120-pound dog in between us.
Shoot. Why do you allow the dog to sleep in the bed?
Hey, did you guys... I didn't show you guys this. So you see that right there, right?
I noticed your bruises earlier, yes.
But wait.
Your right arm's got two bruises. Your left arm
on the same spots on both sides.
What's that?
I don't know.
You don't know where those bruises
are? I don't know where they came from. It's weird.
How about this?
Shoot.
Satan!
You keep your huge...
I don't eat crepes. That's a UK
reference.
Keep
your damn dirty dog off of your bed.
No.
Then don't complain about your fucking bruises, because that's exactly what's happening.
They can't be from the dog if they're on both sides exactly the same on both sides.
It's the stigmata.
You're going to want to... Yeah.
It's a what? A stigma?
Matt gets it. It's the stigmata. You're experiencing signs of the stigmata.
I don't know that.
It's where you've become so Christ-like that you're now experiencing his suffering, and apparently it's migrated to your arms.
I would not have made that joke with Matt here. I would have not. I personally would have not.
It's migrated to her arms.
I have too much respect for you. I would not have made that joke. But isn't it weird?
He likes it. Matt likes it.
Of course.
I actually saw Stigmata when it came out.
The movie? So did I.
But now, like in my current state, there's no way I'd watch it.
Yeah. But isn't that weird that they're... Their markings on both arms, the exact same spot.
You're going to want to get that looked at.
No.
It's the exact same spot.
It's weird.
My guess?
Satan?
Dead within the week.
Oh, God. Oh, if I could.
And I don't mean to.
If I could, Jason, I would. Believe me. Look.
Say it ain't so, Blake. No. I don't want to see that.
I've got the letter already ready.
That file cabinet over there is full of his different suicide notes, depending on when the date is.
Every day of the year.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, 360.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's,
what do you do in, like, a leap year? Right?
Good question.
That's like a crapshoot. You just got to pick the one before or the one after.
February 28th, yeah.
You roll the dead die, right?
Dead die? You say dead die?
You say dead die, too.
Dead die?
Dead die.
Stigmata is a pretty good joke, right? That's pretty funny.
Got me.
All right. It's not blasphemous, is it?
Well, I by no means the authority on that, but
I look to you when I think about blasphemy.
And I look to Blake.
Blasphemous Blake and his judgment.
I think you made Matt uncomfortable. So
now we score, or score, yes, Club Zarathustra.
Now we fourscore.
On a scale
7
of
years ago?
1 to 7, based on the television show we love. It's accurately and affectionately known as Wings from the 1990s. We take a look at all the characters. Number 1... being the worst score you can get, and that's a Roy Biggins. Number 7, that's the best score you can get, that's a Brian Hackett. Matthew, I turn to you. How do you rate Club Zarathustra?
I think this is the first time I've done this, because each of my other episodes I've been on, I came in and I stuck to the number that I walked in with.
Oh, you've changed it while you've been here.
I gave it a bump just based on how much I laughed recapping this thing.
Yes.
Because this thing had like life.
Because me and Jason are pretty funny guys.
We're high five that shit.
I mean, how many layers were there to this?
To this
that
podcast.
You could miss. Well,
there's a
self-aggrandizing.
There really is a lot going on in
this
pilot.
There's a ton going on. Both of you said things that I just flat out missed, because I was either hung up on what just happened or figuring out what's possibly could happen next. The cannon hat actually kind of got me. I want to give a cannon hat bump.
Please.
Have you guys had a cannon hat bump?
I was going to say, oddly enough, that's the first
one
we've had. It is.
Oh, I thought you were going to say that's our second one we've had. So with that all said, I came in with a 3. I am bumping her to a 4.
A cannon bump.
I'm cannon bumping to a 4.
Mm-hmm. Sure. First one ever.
Don't tell your wife.
First cannon bumping. She'll understand.
We won't tell her.
I won't have to say. Yeah, she knows. She'll know what that means.
Just another Thursday night in the Phillips residence.
Says, hey, that's going to kill him. He won't need that note.
He's reaching for one of them.
He's not going to make it.
Today's the 20th of July.
So I'm going to cannon bump it to a 4.
Pick the July 20 date.
Mm.
Pick that suicide note.
21st.
Oh, 21st?
He would have been off today.
They won't pronounce me dead till tomorrow.
Boy, it's a long note.
So a 4. Right down the middle. Captain Philip, rest assured, I turn to you. How do you rate Club the...
I turn to you and say, check your phone.
He texted you his score. I would
do this.
Yeah, I don't want to say it out loud.
He can't say
it. Oh, okay. So, for some reason, you've elected to constantly do...
it's a link to his Instagram.
Chris Tuckley's note on the
pilot. Look at that girl's Tuckley.
Okay.
Get it, Tuckley, because they tuck it.
Man. Oh, I get it.
Pretty funny. Chris Tuckley has not only given us all the links to the episodes that we're doing this season, but he's also provided commentary for the beginning of each episode and ultimately a little summation of what his thoughts on
with
each
his
pilot. With his score. Thank you. Chris says, Club Z is my riskiest submission for the series of couch pilots in that it is the episode that I felt would be most likely to send Jason to a rage, the likes of which we have not seen since Mebox. I would have watched Club Z in the 90s. I liked Attention Scum, which appeared on our TV screens 5 years later and which featured some of the same gags, performers, and characters. The jokes in Club Z are of a familiar mid-90s type, catering to an educated audience and juxtaposing high and low art and rapid changes in tone to create the humor from the surreal effects. One of the main targets and sources for the comedy pretentious art house films and club performance art pieces, but while Club Z laughs at this sort of material, it also belongs to it. Anything longer than 20 minutes for this kind of humor is pushing it, and Club Z risks becoming tiresome. Overall, though, I enjoyed it and laughed a few times. I sponsor a penguin, the bit about Terrence Trent D'Arby coming to dinner, the poet Paul Hamilton. So I'm going to give it a 5.
Hey, nice. He has a gift.
Very well worded.
He
really has a gift.
He's educated, obviously.
Yeah. He's a historian.
I still don't understand why he listens to this
show. And you never will. So don't even try. Listen, there are some things that I agree with, absolutely here with him. But Captain Philip Rester, again, I do have to turn to you and ask, what do you rate Club Z? Club.
At first, I started watching this, and I was like, oh, what the fuck is going on?
Sure.
And then I started to go, I don't... Again, there's a language barrier for me. Just like season 17. I liked it. At the end of it, I was not upset that I watched it. And normally the stuff that we watch, you're like, I feel a little guilty or upset that I watched it. I liked the hat bits. They were very Monty Python to me. The hat bits were very Monty Python to me. I kind of liked the whole like dictatorship kind of like, I'm telling you what you're going to laugh at. I'm telling you what's going to... I'm going to give this a 6.
Mercy. Wow, a 6.
A 6. I enjoyed it.
Very high score.
Well played, Chris.
Wow.
What? My name is Blake.
Well, you can be Blake too.
Why'd you say well played, Chris?
Mr. Tuckley, he submitted it.
My score.
He threw it out in the middle. You gave it a 6.
All right, relax.
No. He doesn't like it.
Okay.
I think Shaquille O'Neal is the greatest champion ever. Oh, we not Hampson. Why he got involved with Papa John's, I don't understand. Can we talk about
there was a vacuum to be yeah, there was a vacuum to be filled there.
It's a delicious pizza product.
Can we have this one-on-one tournament?
Papa John's, sure.
Seriously?
Sure.
To 11?
Yeah. What, best of three?
He's going...
No. One game.
You just want one game?
I can't last.
He's going to kill you. He's going
to... No, he's not. No, he's not. Let's do this.
You better have one hell of a hook shot, my friend.
Sky hook, baby. Are you like Hakeem the Dream?
No. I'm going straight to the basket. I'm driving straight to the basket.
I like it.
We can't imagine that would work, but
we're
going
to do this, right? 2-11.
Win by two. I always play win by two.
Huh?
He plays win by two. He said he plays win by two. What did you not get?
I didn't hear him. Can we do this?
Ones and twos.
Can we film this? Can we do this?
Well, so you're going to
do you have a basketball hoop at your house?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Okay, will your wife allow us to be outside?
Well, I mean,
in your driveway,
she's not gonna like it.
No, if we're outside, if I promise not to come in.
No, gosh, no.
Can we do this?
We should do it. We should go to a real court.
Though. Absolutely, do this.
Did you say a real court?
Yeah, we should go to like a court. We play a couple times a week in all different. Yeah, we've got a court.
Indoors or outdoors?
But depending on time of the year, yeah.
And
outdoors, right?
In
now.
A few weeks from now.
Well, no. Like in like 1 week from now. So we can record it and tack it on the end of this episode. Do not push out.
Are we really doing this?
Do not push out. This would be.
I will.
Are
not
we
push
really
out.
Doing this?
Yes. Okay. Yeah. We will do it. You bring some recording equipment or borrow some from Kevin or whatever. Some ones that we can transport. We'll do it.
We should probably. We can't play to 11 because that's a lot of film. Can we play to 6? Win by 2? 6 win by 2.
No.
11.
We'll do 11. Right, we'll do 11.
You want to go to 11.
I promise you it'll be 5 minutes or less. We'll tack it on the end of this episode, and it'll be great. You cannot puss out on this.
I brought it up. Well, I would not puss out on it. I brought it
I
up.
I don't know what to do with this. I'm trying to stay as clean here
as I
can.
Yeah. You'll figure it out. You'll organize it. You can't puss out. I'm going to push to make it happen, and then we'll just tack it on the end of this episode.
So we just played the other day. We got a bunch of guys. Believe it or not, we are going to start. We're going to try to start like streaming our basketball.
That's a good idea.
And find like 6 guys around the planet that want to watch it or laugh at it.
That's cool.
Yeah, we're going to stream it.
All right. What did you say?
I said it's cool.
Oh, my score? Funny you should ask.
I forgot about you.
I know that you did. Chris says that this might evoke some sort of rage from me. It doesn't.
I was going to say, you bottled it really well if it did.
This came out in 1996. This catches a 15-year-old Jason at the perfect time. An influential Jason who was watching The State on MTV.
Mm-hmm. Nice.
Possibly an American version of Club Zarathustra, except it doesn't have that sort of culty...
It's more political, though, right?
I don't know if I'd even call The State political.
I'm saying that the Club Z is probably more political than The State.
I would be more comfortable saying faux political, as in they're giving the illusion
of a government or something.
That's
right.
Yeah.
The State, I would call me among its members of its cult in that I've watched The State.
You watched the Zoom.
And I have followed The State and the members of it and all their different ventures over the past 25 years. Club Z, if this were to come on in America at this time and have continued on, this probably would have caught me at the right time, and it made me a devotee of these people going forward. He also goes on to say, Chris does anyway, that the sources for the comedy is pretentious art house films. These people are in their young, like early to mid-20s. It is wildly pretentious what they're doing.
Mm-hmm. Right.
He completely nails it.
Yeah.
And in that, there's something to be said about being overly confident. I fall under that spell. When people are overly confident, I often submit to what they're doing because they're so confident. I feel like I would submit to this. Like, what they're doing is so over the top, and they're confident about what they're doing. I would fall under the spell of whatever they're doing here. Mm-hmm. I agree with Chris. This is a 5. I enjoyed this. This was absurd to the point where I didn't understand all the references, but they were doing funny things. It wasn't all great. Some of the hat bits I didn't think were that funny, honestly. Yeah. But there was a lot of good stuff going on here. I like this. I'd be interested to see where it went, if it went further. I give it a 5. Chris gives it a 5.
I'm the lowest score. I'm never the lowest score.
You give
it a 4.
Ever. Yeah. And Blake, I'm surprised to say that you give this a 6. And with those scores, we close the book on Club Zarathustra, and we will never mention it again.
Yep.
But join us next time, won't you please, when we watch the pilot episode of Squidge and the Hardnuts.
Naturally.
Here's a little something to whet your whistle. Soft CGI characters Squidge and Splat show us that it's okay to be different in the hard 3D modeled world of the Hardnuts.
It's a hard nut life. For me.
For us.
I was going to wait to you.
Don't even ask me how I spell that.
I wouldn't even venture a guess. You can find the entire episode of Squidge and the Hardnuts by subscribing to Couch Pilots in Spotify or Apple Podcasts or your favorite podcast app of choice, and then simply click on one of our classically blue links in our show notes or go to YouTube.
And
Matthew?
You'll know what to do, Tubes.
That's exactly right. Go to couchpilotspodcast.com. Our extensive back catalog of damn near 250 episodes are all available there. Go to Facebook. Thank you. That's a lot of episodes. Go to Facebook, Twitter, and if you dare, go to Instagram. Now, I would use our Instagram as a vehicle to find Blake's Instagram to see who he's following.
Brace yourself.
Or just enjoy it.
Or you can give us a call.
Really thin out your audience.
We had a great...
How do you thin out 3 people?
Yeah, go down to 1 or 2. That's pretty bad. 910 Pilots 1, 910-745-6871. We had a great call today from Ted Bundy. And I tell you what.
Ted Kennedy.
Serial killer or not, he's getting frequent flyer points.
Hey, if they're incarcerated or not.
Ted Bundy from the grave.
It's none of our business whether they're alive or
from
dead.
From the afterlife.
He's alive.
Al Bundy?
No, Ted Bundy is alive.
We can also go to Patreon. Don't wink at my friend. Don't wink at Matt. Don't you ever wink at him.
I'm going to wink at him when I fucking jam on his ass on the basketball court.
Ooh. I hope to God that after I say the exit line here, it goes right into our exit song and then right in to your guys' basketball foray. Go to Patreon. No one said jam on you since 1994. Go to patreon.com.
My wife did.
search for Couch Pilots. You can give us money to do the show. It's free. I can't imagine you would give us money, but if you want to encourage us to keep doing it, then give us a few bucks. We would take it.
Yeah.
Here's my offer. After Blake said that, it can be you and Molly versus me.
No. Don't need it.
It can be anyone that you find with the last name Clayton versus Matt.
How about
me? That's 3, 4, 5 people.
How about me, the power tool of my choice?
Gosh. Oh, mercy.
No, Matt, I can be 2-1. I can be 2-1. It's
Matt, you have to respond. You don't have to say anything.
What do I say?
I'm telling you, you don't have to say anything.
Say, yeah, let's do this.
Bring the heat. Although I could say,
bring the fajita meat.
I can't wait to jam on you.
I can't do it. That laugh.
I can't wait to jam on
you. I'm just thinking. I don't know. But you know Jay Will. I play a guy who's very, very, very talented.
What are you trying to say?
Jay Will.
I mean, but he plays a lot. Let me ask you this, in fairness. When's the last time you played? Like one-on-one, like hardcore one-on-one?
When's the last time you've...
went one-on-one hardcore? No, it's been a while.
You've ran. Huh? When's the last time you've gone past a brisk walk as far as speed?
I'm going to beat him.
Okay.
It doesn't matter. I'm going to beat him.
I'd almost rather sub me out and put in like Jay Will.
Don't be a dasshole.
No, Jay Will. No.
I know. Don't come soft. If you don't come hard, don't come at all. Seriously, me and you.
You.
It's 211.
It's on. We don't have to do it anymore.
Well,
we have such a good relationship. No. I don't want to sully our relationship in any way.
You think you're going to school me so bad that I'm not going to be your friend? I know I'm going to win.
What he's going to do, he's going to cross you over so bad, you're going to break your ulna, your urna, your tibia, and your
Santa Maria.
And your Santa Maria. Anytime you have a limb with two bones in it, they will all break. That's how bad he's going to cross you over.
It's fine. Whatever.
Matt,
go ahead. Go ahead and just...
He's done. He's done.
He's laughing so hard. He's like, oh, I've got this. No, this guy's 46. He has a heart condition. He smokes drinks.
No, I'm just thinking... Oh, gosh. Okay.
You're just thinking what? Ready. What are you thinking?
He's impressed with my knowledge of the skeletal system.
Okay. All right. Real quick.
I thought we were starting the Mamba 5 over here.
What's the score going to be at the end?
It's
2-11. You're going to win by 2.
11-0.
It's going to be a Roy Biggins.
the score will be 11-0.
I win. Well, I get 11. Matt gets 0.
I don't know about that.
You ever see my D?
What?
It's on his Instagram.
All right, enough of that. Matt, do you have anything you want to promote? Is there anything you want to talk about?
Well, I was going to talk about streaming our 3-on-3 basketball. That's kind of in its infancy right now, but the first thing we're going to stream is this one-on-one match. But I want to make sure... that right here, right now, no matter what the outcome of this, it does not change that whatever we have here. I want it on the record.
No, it would never do that.
And you can't come back to him and say, I want you to pay my medical bills for my ulna, urna, tibia, fibia.
But I want to say, I want to up the
3, 4, 5.
I want to up the ante. I want to up the ante.
Mara.
Little bit of ulna in my thigh.
In my thighs.
I want to up the ante.
I broke my ulna.
I want to up the ante. One level.
Okay.
I want to play for a pair of my blue jeans.
And if you win,
what size do you wear?
Yeah, what the hell is he gonna do with those?
No, we're gonna go jeans on jeans.
It's a jeans match.
It's a jeans match.
These aren't my pants.
Jeans to the death.
What, 32s, 34s?
No.
Where are you at?
No. Oh, yeah. 30.
I guess 34s.
32 waist, 34 length.
Okay.
You're 32 okay. waist?
That's good.
Yeah. Nice.
So what we're going to do. We each throw a pair of jeans.
Tommy Hilfigers.
We're going to throw a pair of jeans at the end the bottom awesome. Of the... This is awesome. And so whoever loses has to put the other pair of jeans on.
On site.
On site. Fist bump on it, coronavirus.
I'll be there to video record it. We'll put that on Facebook. And then we'll have recording devices to tack on to the end of the show.
Sure.
Okay?
Beautiful.
Let's do it. It's in the works.
I'm good.
I'll draw the court.
Do you have anything?
What do you mean, draw the court?
Don't worry about that. Tell us about,
what does that mean?
No. Tell us about a British person. And make it quick. I don't want a fucking 20-minute thing like last time.
No, this was... Look how quick it is.
All right, hurry up.
It generally hurts.
John George Heng... He was born in 1909 on July 24th.
This is giving us information about a British person since we're doing the
test. A famous British person.
Yeah.
And he died on August 10th, 1949. Some mention he's 40 years old. He's commonly known as the Acid Bath Murderer.
Oh, my God.
He was an English serial killer who was convicted for the murders of... Do me a start over.
No.
Don't do that.
You're fucking... I'm taking you to the wreck.
He's going to do a slam dunk shot off on you if you're not careful.
Okay.
What? You're so confident.
I've never seen you so cocky.
I
haven't heard someone say take you to the rack in probably 25 years.
I didn't want to say take you to the hole because then he would say something inappropriate.
I'm sorry. Oh, I do not.
Take it to the hole.
I would never say that.
Oh.
You guys want to hear about John George Heng?
I would like to hear about him, yes.
He was known as the Acid Bath Murderer. He was an English serial killer who was convicted for the murders of 6 people, although he claimed to have killed 9. He battered to death or shot his victims and disposed of their bodies using sulfuric acid before forging their signatures. So he could sell their possessions and collect large sums of money.
This is a real thing.
Oh, yeah. No, I have a list of 20. I had to pick 10.
I feel like there's a theme coming on.
No,
with these
it's just famous people that
just famous that, people in the UK.
Yeah, people in the UK might know about.
Okay. Well, thank you, Blake, for that. And Matt, thank you so much for I'm going to go out on a limb and say Matt is our number one guest.
Yes.
That's going a long way. And I apologize if anything came across as overconfidence. I genuinely mean that.
I get sucked into overconfidence. No, you guys.
I was laughing so hard at some of the basketball vocabulary. I was in stitches.
I want to shoot the rock.
Believe it or not, every now and then you'll still hear it referred to as the Rock.
Yeah, I wish it was a ball, or I wish it was a little tall.
Could we have Skilo be playing?
Sure, I'll play it right now. This pilot may have been rough, but it's always a smooth flight here on Couch Pilots. Thanks, everyone, and we'll see you next time.
You're going down.
It's the Mamba Fire.
Some gin and juice, but I really don't wanna. Feel blues like I had last week. I must stay deep, just talking to deep. I like Angela, Pamela, Sarah, and Rita. And as I continue, you know they're getting sweeter. So what can I do? I really thank you, my lord. To be a friend is just like a sport. Anything fine, it's all good. Let me jump in, please sing in the trumpet. A little bit of Monica in my life. A little bit of